So hello, welcome to our periodic webinars for the Syracuse IP Tech Center and Sipley webinar series and YouTube channel. It's my great pleasure to introduce Professor Kevin Greene, also goes by KJ Greene, currently a professor at California Western Law School. Amazing set of backgrounds, both former Marine, Yale Law School graduate, and spent a couple of years at a cravath law firm. I was joking earlier, asked to which was worse, the Marines or cravath, and I'm sure Professor Greene will illuminate us about that. He also has a consulting law firm is more of a consulting firm, or is it more of a law firm?
Expert witness consulting.
Expert witness, which you can find more about at, I hope I get this right, www.kevinjgreene.com. Is that right?
Correct.
Okay, great. When he's going to talk to us about IP's role in protest movements from music to trademarks. And I'll just turn it over to you, Professor Greene. Thank you for joining us. We look forward to this, and it should be a great discussion and presentation.
Okay, great. Thanks so much, Professor Ghosh Schuber, who I've known for many years now. I consider a great colleague, a great friend, and also just amazing as an academic and all the things that he does. Somebody I've always admired a ton. And so thank you so much for inviting me. It's a great honor to be here at Syracuse, where I spoke, I want to say, back in 07. There was a seminar. That's the last time that I was able to join you guys. So that was about trademarks. But we'll talk about trademarks, copyrights, and some other things in this presentation. And as Shuba was indicating, I do have a background on Wall Street, but also the entertainment industry. I've represented a lot of different music artists. So I just want to tell you a little bit about my background, a little bit more, to give you some context. So as an attorney at an entertainment boutique in New York City, I represented clients like Bobby Brown, Chuck D. We represented Spike Lee and his movie production company. And in more recent years, I don't actually practice law, although I'm still admitted in New York. I primarily work as a consultant to law firms who have thorny intellectual property issues, whether copyright, trademark, or publicity rights. On the far right there is the Hubris Lemonade. And of course, my most recent engagement was a right of publicity trial involving the heirs of the Hanson Juice family and Coca-Cola. And actually that, I was on the expert for the plaintiffs, the Hanson Juice family, and that was a $9.5 million verdict, very exciting. And over there on the left, of course, is George Clinton, who I went up to the Ninth Circuit with back about 4 or 5 years ago now, and in a case that was very heartbreaking because he ended up losing most of his musical sound recordings. So that's kind of my experience and background. So I was pretty much out there almost before anybody else in kind of making this link between intellectual property and race and gender issues. And at that time, in the early 2000s, it was not a common thing that people were talking about. There was a lot of derision in some cases of me raising these issues. And now with this new movement, which we'll talk about, these issues have become so germane. And there's actually movement and traction, not only in the United States, in order to make a more equal IP system. And Shuba writes about this, I know, in the patent space, but also to internationally. South Africa, I've been working with Professor Sean Flynn at American University, and we've been consulting with these South Africans who are trying to revise their copyright law at this moment to make it more fair and equitable for artists of all types. So that's kind of been my work. Of course, when we think about IP theory, we think often first about these economic theories of intellectual property, including incentive theory and copyright. And when I looked at these various theories and studied them in law school and the like, I thought, there's something missing here. Because all these guys are talking about this ideal economic world where, we can maximize wealth with intellectual property. We can provide incentives to artists and inventors and the like. And I looked at the space of African-American creativity, and this stuff really wasn't working, like they said in these various books about it. And that's when I started really digging down on this project of how is it that African-American artists who are arguably the most creative, or one of the most creative at least, groups in American society have contributed so much to American culture and to American economic fortunes and received so little out of it. So that was really how I got started in this project. And as I looked at it, I realized that no academics were talking about this. And yet there it was right in their faces. It was in the cases. It was in the doctrine. Of course, the Bismarcky case, the first sampling case, the Gray album controversy about what's permitted on the internet to share and not share. Two Live Crew, the Acuff Campbell case, Acuff Music case, V. Campbell, where the Supreme Court set the standard for fair use. It's still the standard that's with us today. The Cosby Show, one of the leading cases about idea misappropriation, and on and on and on. And so African-Americans were appearing in these cases and in the case law, but no one was analyzing how they're situated differently, perhaps, than others in the system. And that's been my project for close to 20 years now. I identified early on these various challenges that IP poses to African-American cultural production. And all these are copyright doctrines that have severely impacted and harmed the fortunes and the credit of African-American artists. And I'm not going to talk about all those today, but just to put it in some background. And again, this is an international, global problem too. We're all familiar with the Lion Sleeps Tonight case, where Solomon Linda, a Zulu tribesman back in the early 1900s, came up with the Wimbawe melody, which was later used by Disney to literally make millions upon millions of dollars without any compensation to Solomon Linda or his family. So these issues have been very much foremost on my mind and in my scholarship over the last close to 20 years. I talk about these racial and gender dynamics and intellectual property, and we can go all the way back to the minstrel show paradigm, which was a paradigm where African-American cultural creativity was appropriated by the dominant white population, and it also was distorted, right, through things like minstrelsy. And there, of course, we have Al Jolson, who was known as the jazz singer in a movie. He performed in blackface, and that was American Music History 101. It was not only appropriation, it was distortion. Now, I don't think we have the distortion as much today, but we still have the appropriation piece that we have to deal with. And by the way, Al Jolson, by all accounts, was actually a pretty nice guy who actually tried to do good things for African-Americans. And there's some evidence that he wasn't a bad guy, but still he performed in blackface. We'll talk about Aunt Jemima and that whole trademark program, paradigm of how trademarks have been one of the leading forces in promoting racial stereotypes in American society. And I'll talk about the Aunt Jemima controversy of today here shortly, time permitting. I'm just checking my time to make sure I don't go over time. All the commonalities are we have appropriation, we have deprivation of copyright, deprivation of trademark, deprivation of image for right of publicity, all throughout American history, up to very recent times. And IP has been at the center of that, right? That whole dynamic. And that's really what my work has been about. My work is not only backward looking, though, it's very much forward looking. And that's why I'm very excited that thanks to Shuba and a lot of other academics, I'm pretty much being invited all over the place. I actually have, I can't do any more speaking engagements, I have too many. Because this work, which I started 20 years ago, now is more germane than it ever was. And people are very interested in hearing about it. So I'm very excited about that. Of course, let's bring it up to today. There's Mr. Trump, of course. And most recently, he has led this attack by the Trump administration against critical theory. Critical theories are things like feminist studies, like critical race studies and critical theory generally. And they are now positing that this is a great evil in American society, which means like people like me, in essence, will have a target on their back, right? If there's gonna be a roundup, I'm gonna be one of the first people they round up, no doubt about it, right?
Yeah.
He has ordered these federal agencies not to do, was that?
So November 3rd, vote.
November 3rd. He's ordered these federal agencies not to allow any sort of training or to try to get more diversity and more inclusiveness in the U.S. government. Anything that mentions either white supremacy or white privilege will be banned, according to Mr. Trump. And that would be things like the 1619 Project, which is a reimagination of American history through the lens of slavery. Just pardon me one second. I'm so sorry about this. My dog is locked out and she's going to keep crying. Just one.
I'll just pause this for a minute then.
Good roll tape.
Okay, let's go.
All right, great. So this is all happening right now in America. This says the Trump administration's attack on CRT, critical race theory, is basically anti-American. And of course, he's been beating the drum about this. Of course, I was one of the first people, not the first person, to really turn the lens of critical race theory in the IP space. And I think that it's a mistake to, first of all, associate this with Marxism, which I see in the news. It has nothing to do with Marxism. It's completely separate from that. But these perspectives really help us understand and make sense of the world. That's what theory is supposed to do, make sense of the world. And whereas neoclassical economics theory can't really account for the treatment of African Americans and other subordinated groups in society, critical race theory can. Where it might be short is more in prescriptions, but certainly in helping us analyze, it's very, very powerful. There's Derrick Bell, who's the founder of the critical race movement. He passed away a number of years ago, a great man. And critical race recognizes that subordination is real, that some people in American society are not equal to others. And it also focuses on looking at the bottom of society if we're gonna make reforms in the legal system. And this could not be a better thing to do in the IP space, to look at how copyright law is treating the artist in the South Bronx who has a junior high school education. We should pattern our law after those people to benefit. And by the way, that that notion is totally consistent with Rawlsian principles of distributive justice. Rawls talks about that. He says we should look to people who are the least advantaged and see how the law affects them. And that's how we know whether the law is working or not. Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm gonna skip through some stuff because I talked about that a little bit. On the trademark side, and Professor Ghost knows a lot about trademarks as well. There was a time when America woke up with Aunt Jemima and Rastus, the cream of wheat chef. Mm-hmm. They brushed their teeth with darky toothpaste. They might have eaten some inward hair tobacco, and at night they could eat Uncle Ben's rice, right, for it. So all these trademarks have had real impact on how people are treated in society. They're not just trademarks.
And as you probably heard the news story today, that Uncle Ben's, I think it's got a new name. I forget what it is. Ben's.
It's, do you remember? Yeah, right. Yes, I heard that.
It was in the news, yeah. I'll try to put a link to it in the YouTube comments, yeah. Sorry, go ahead. I just thought I'd point that out.
No, please, I love you. Interject whenever you wish, Professor. So of course, now we have this Black Lives Matter movement, which is really much more than about Black lives. Yeah, it is. It's a new civil rights movement that's gonna sweep in a lot of different groups who historically have not had their fair share in the United States. And I believe it's gonna turn intellectual property and how people look at intellectual property upside down. So when I started doing this work about African Americans and in IP, I was not so implicitly put in a fringe corner. They say, there's Greene, he's on the fringe. He's the black guy who talks about black things in copyright and in trademark and the like. But what I was saying from the beginning and what is not, couldn't be more clear now, is not a fringe issue, because intellectual property, and particularly on the creative side, the copyright side, the right publicity side, is driven by black culture. I often joke, there isn't much American culture left if we African-Americans were somehow to be kicked out of this country and take everything with us. It would hardly be anything, right? On the artistic side anyway, and the popular artistic side to do. So this movement is very, very important and people are listening. And it's a global movement which extends all the way to South Africa and to other nations who are looking for equity and fairness in a system. Of course, we recently heard, Shuba was talking about Uncle Ben's. Look at MasterCard. That corporation is putting in $500 million, $500 million in the African-American community. And the only reason this is happening is because of the Black Lives Matter movement. It wasn't happening before that. But when I look at that, Shuba, I think about the American entertainment industry and the American music industry, the music industry particularly is built on the backs of African Americans. There is no American music industry without us, period. And where is that happening? Now, I understand that Warner Brothers and some companies have initiatives out there and ASCAP and the like to contribute back. But we're not talking about $500 million from a backward-looking perspective. We're talking about over $1 trillion, right, to make things right with the American music industry alone. And so we're wondering when that's gonna begin, right, rather than so-called peanuts that are being, passed out here and there by these corporations. I told you about the South African copyright revision. There's the president of South Africa who was about to sign their copyright bill. That bill actually requires artists to be paid fair compensation. It's in the bill. Mm-hmm. And if they haven't been paid fair royalties and compensation, they have to make adjustments. It was passed by their parliament. It was sent to the president who was going to sign it. And then suddenly he sent it back. And we can probably imagine who influenced him. He was heavily influenced by our American government, Copyright Office, the Trade Office, and also American corporations who basically threatened South Africa to say, if you pass this bill, we're going to pull up stakes out of South Africa. Can you imagine that? If there's a bill that says you've got to get fair compensation, we'll pull up stakes, right, in your country. Yeah. And rather than do that, I think that's fairly extraordinary. Okay, the civil rights movement, of course, was a 1950s, 1960s movement. We're in a new one now. And in this part, I just wanted to talk a little bit about how copyright actually affected people in the movement. So here's Dr. Martin Luther King. And if you don't mind, Shubha, I was going to play a clip.
Sure.
This playlist is called BLM.
I have the pleasure to present to you Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr. I am happy to join with you today in what will go down in history as the greatest demonstration for freedom in the history of our nation. Five score years ago, a great American in whose symbolic shadow we stand today signed the Emancipation Proclamation. This momentous decree came as a great beacon light of hope to millions of Negro slaves who had been seared in the flames of withering injustice. It came as a joyous daybreak to end the long night of their captivity. But 100 years later, the Negro still is not free. 100 years later, the life of the Negro is still sadly crippled by the manacles of segregation and the chains of discrimination.
So that's Dr. Martin Luther King. In 1963, he gave his famous I Have a Dream speech, and that's the beginning of it in Washington, D.C. A lot of people don't know that he also had previously given the speech in Detroit prior to that. That's not well known by people. And of course, the fight in this case was the copyright over Dr. King's dream speech. Here's what happened. After the march, he got with Motown Records and they cut a deal to put his speech on sound recordings and distribute them around the country. And by the way, there was great demand for those, for people who wanted to hear that wonderful speech. We didn't have an internet then and they wanted to be there. But there were a bunch of other record companies who beat Motown to the punch and started selling unauthorized albums with the dream speech on it. He registered the speech in 63 and he went after these pirates in the Southern District of New York. That's what happened in the case. Now, he, at that time, copyright had these weird formalities. This is under the 1909 Copyright Act. And one of the formalities is that if you published your speech, which meant you distributed it to the public, before registration, then you lost your copyright. It was dedicated to the public domain. So the argument was that he had already given the speech in Detroit and again in DC, and that constituted a publication. He didn't have a registration. And because of that, they said his speech was injected into the public domain, which means that anybody could use it and King and his estate later would have no rights to it. If you read the opinion in the case, in the New York court, the federal court, you'll see that they basically skirted the law and allowed him to keep his copyright. But mm-hmm. Technically, if you really look at the letter of copyright law, he should have lost that speech. And I raise this because this was one of the banes of African-American creators, that we had these very rigid formalities in copyright law, that you really almost needed to be a copyright lawyer in advance to try to protect your copyright. And there are tons of examples of works being injected into the public domain, which means the person who created them receives nothing. The public gets it, but the creator gets nothing. And so that's why I thought it was very salient, the Dr. King case. And the court, the New York court, goes through a very tortured kind of a recitation of why, when he gave the speech in D.C. and Detroit, it actually wasn't a publication. So I don't see how that possibly was, but the court held otherwise. I think, Shubha, you know what I'm talking about. That was
Just to emphasize what you're talking about, this goes to any kind of performance. I mean, if the music is performed before, you know, in a public place, you could lose copyright.
Correct.
Theater. I mean, think about the wide range of creative arts that are affected by this old, you know, divested of publication problem, right? I mean, there's
a lot
of these cases where the court tries to preserve copyright under the 1909 Copyright Act.
They went into conniptions, basically, to allow Dr. King to keep his copyright in those speeches.
Yeah.
Okay, on the publicity right side, right of publicity protects a person's name, likeness, photograph, picture, and their image, in essence. And of course, this company decided that they would make a bunch of busts of Dr. King, which only King or his estate can authorize that. And so that was another instance of people basically trying to appropriate the intellectual property of the great Dr. King. Okay, we're all probably familiar with this song, which is the anthem of the civil rights movement.
We shall overcome. We shall overcome. We shall overcome someday.
Interesting case to me, because the origins of We Shall Overcome were apparently these striking workers, I think in Arkansas, I might be wrong on the location, but somewhere in the South. And a woman heard them singing the song on the picket line. She ended up taking the song and publishing it. And in 1940s, the Pete Singer, the great singer, also obtained a copyright in a new version of it, this version that we see. So there were a number of versions of the song, right?
Yeah.
At the end of the day, it was Pete Seeger actually said he admitted he didn't write it, and all the proceeds were supposed to be donated to charity, just in Pete Seeger's defense, right? So he wasn't using this for personal gain. But the point of the matter is whether this song actually, based on the various versions, was still under copyright. That's what this fight was about. Of course, it's a beautiful song, and it's a historic song, one of the most important songs in American history. And the lawsuit, which was later on in the 2000s, was looking at whether or not the song was in copyright. This is the movie Lee Daniels, The Butler. And they asked the publishing company, Ludlow, who owned the versions to a 1947 version of it, if they could use the song. And they were like, well, we want like $100,000 or something like that for you to use the song, which is not uncommon, by the way, in the movie business. And so this group of plaintiffs, it was a class of them, said, we don't actually think that song is still under copyright. And you've been collecting royalties on a song when you shouldn't be. Now, to me, they said it was you just took an old black spiritual, right? And redid it. And the original version is the right one. And this song should be in the public domain. That was the argument they made. They actually prevailed on this argument, which is, Shubha, was kind of surprising to me that they did. I was surprised they won this case. And the court held that this work was in the public domain. And after that, before Judge Coates in the federal court, they agreed to settle to make sure that the melody and lyrics of the song are in the public domain. So now anybody can use We Shall Overcome. But to me, like in the Dr. King case, the bigger point here is that there are tons of songs that are under copyright that aren't really owned by the people who claim to be owning them. And a big part of my work now, Shuba, and the reform I'm looking to is just that. And I hope I can get some traction on it, because the Copyright Office, and I have good friends in the Copyright Office, so I want to make clear I'm not attacking individuals, but I'm attacking the system, has no, in my mind, has no credibility and no accountability. There are way too many works that are registered, and the people who claim it and who are profiting from it do not own those rights. And there's no vetting of works that go through the Copyright Office. It's minimal vetting. Right. I joke with my students that if you send a hamburger to the Copyright Office, they won't register it. But almost anything else that's not a hamburger, they'll register. And I noticed that since I started talking about this, and I'm probably too arrogant to make this claim, that they've started doing more rejections in the Copyright Office. I can't take credit for that, but I have noticed that the number has been creeping up. So maybe they're getting the message.
And so in this case, could you talk, do you have a sense of what kind of evidence they brought in to show that there was this public domain source for the song that was actually the spirituals? I mean, it must be interesting to see how you prove that, right?
Right. They did bring in evidence, and they actually found evidence, historical record of these, I think there's actually like a film clip of the people on that picket line in the state that's striking African-American workers who were singing the song.
I see.
They brought in evidence like that. This is not an uncommon thing. We about the Happy Birthday case, of course, Happy Birthday Warner Brothers, which ended up owning the rights. They were making money on that song for like 25 years, I want to say, that they weren't entitled to.
And if you
add that all up, it was millions upon millions of dollars.
Right.
And in order for us to really have equity and fairness in our copyright system, I think we would need a complete, kind of audit, so to speak, of what's been copyrighted and by whom. And in this presentation, I don't have time, but I can give you tons of examples of African-American artists who've had their works registered by people who aren't the creators of those works and who've received nothing. Go ahead.
I'm sorry to interrupt. Was the point in the case that the picketers had taken the song from the spiritual? Or, I mean, what was the actual provenance of the song? What was the history? Do you know? I mean, was it?
Right. Well, it was heard by somebody who heard the workers. I forget the lady's name.
She was the initial
one who published it. Then there were various versions that were published. There was Pete Seeger had his version, and there was another version that was owned by this Ludlow Corporation, and they were the ones who were saying, we're the rightful copyright owner in this.
Okay. Yes. Yeah. Interesting.
So
okay.
That ends up being important. But I just, just on this area of people registering stuff and owning copyrights they shouldn't, and I think I'm permitted to say this because we're going to have a conference about this on Friday with T.S. Monk, who is the son of the legendary Thelonious Monk. And he's going to talk about this. Again, I'm not revealing confidential things. He's going to talk about this, he said, in the presentation on Friday. But the song Around Midnight.
Where's that conference? I can put a link to it since I'll post this. Probably.
Sure. It's the California Copyright Conference is what it's called.
Yeah. Okay. I'll do that.
So Thelonious Monk alone wrote Around Midnight, which is one of the greatest jazz standards in the history of jazz. It might be the number one jazz standard, right? Recorded, re-recorded by everybody. Well, he ended up signing his rights away at Around Midnight. Someone else published it and copyrighted it, and he didn't receive compensation for that song until many years later, I guess, when his lawyers were able to wrest some money. When I forget who was the right holders. I want to say it was Columbia Sony. Sony wanted something else. They wanted to make the movie about Thelonious Monk. And so they were like, the estate was like, well, if you want that, then we want a piece of Around Midnight back. So this is a pervasive problem that no one's talking about.
Yeah.
In our copyright system. And these cases indicated they didn't own the rights to the song to monopolize it and charge people. Okay, I'm going to skip some of this in the interest of time.
Sure. We can share these slides. I assume you can. We can put a link to them as well.
Yes. So the other thing, of course, is that, music, of course, has played a key role in all these music from We Shall Overcome to this fellow.
Put your pants up.
Again, right?
Yeah. Some people say we got a lot.
I love this one.
Bill Scott Heron, yeah.
ho, brother. You will not be able to plug in, turn on, and cop out. You will not be able to lose yourself on Stag and skip out for beer during commercials because the revolution will not be televised.
Hey, what's up now?
Brother, what's up? This is a big party, man.
Yeah, brother, like it. Right on.
This song can be written today, right? With everything that's happening. That's it.
There's too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you dying.
Come on, but they were seeking billions of dollars in that case. It goes nowhere, though. Okay, I'm going to go through these pretty quick. 120 million breakfasts a day in 1910. This is a major. Part of American culture and American history. There's the purported grave of Nancy Greene. I wonder if that's going to be remedied finally.
Where is that?
That's where she's buried, in Chicago. Yeah, it's a, you know, as you can see, unmarked grave there. Wow. By the way, the history of IP in America, including trademark and copyright, there's a lot of people in unmarked graves who start out, Bessie Smith, for example, Jelly Roll Morton, I can go through the list of all these great American innovators, and somehow at the end of the day, they're buried in a place like this. And we really have to ask ourselves, if we take justice seriously, why we don't have IP justice? Why don't we have copyright justice? Where is that? You know, maybe not as salient as, you know, deadly police force, but still an enormously, enormously important issue. As Schubert was pointing out, Uncle Ben's, they pulled the plug on him, and they're going to call it Ben's Original.
Ben's Original.
Assuming they're going to get rid of the blackface image of the individual, I don't remember his name, who was the original Uncle Ben.
Yeah, there was a lot, I'm sorry, in the Ben's Original, there was a lot in the news stories talking about how the marketing surveys, I mean, I don't, it would be interesting to go in to see exactly what they did, but they, you know, the company is touting how they started to look at a broader consuming audience in terms of test marketing the brand. So, I mean, they didn't expressly go into what the demographics were, but it's interesting to see how these brands get created, you know.
I spoke with my big time trademark lawyer friends, and we all agreed that in terms of Aunt Jemima, this had to have been years in the making. You don't just overnight pull the plug on a multi-billion dollar brand.
Right.
So obviously they've been thinking about this for some time. And I think the Black Lives Matter movement kind of was the last nail in the coffin that kind of pushed them to do it. Yeah. The real question is, what are the Redskins going to do? Are they going to keep that shoe, or are they going to get rid of that racist mark?
Oh, I've heard the pressure is to get rid of it. The hard part is to figure out what to replace it with. I mean, you have the same thing with all these school mascots that are, I mean, I don't know.
In
what
my mind, Chuba, that's the worst one of all.
Yeah.
I don't even like to say that word, you know?
Redskins, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, it's.
Here's Warner Brothers.
Talk about genocide, you know.
The General Lee from that silly show has to go with the Confederate flag on top.
Yeah.
And of course, every time this happens, there's a huge cultural backlash of people who love the Confederate flag, who think there's nothing wrong with it, and who quite honestly, get extremely angry about this in our society. We're seeing that at all times. More recently, the Dixie Chicks decided to ditch the Dixie moniker and just call themselves the Chicks now. Mm-hmm. The Lady A dispute is a pretty interesting one. There were two Lady A's. There's Lady A on the left, who's an African-American woman who's performing under that name for over 20 years as a blues kind of R&B singer. And then there's Lady Antebellum, the... I don't know how to correct. I don't listen to them, so I assume it's some sort of country music type group.
Or in that genre.
Rockabilly.
I don't know exactly. Yeah.
So they decided, in the light of this new movement, to change their name because Antebellum refers to the South, right? During the period of slavery.
Yeah.
And they decided to ditch that. Yeah, before the Civil War. Mm-hmm. But they forgot about her. And this ended up almost being worse than what they intended because they were trying to do something good by ditching the Lady Antebellum name, and they put themselves into a big controversy because this woman who has been performing for so many years has said, wait a minute, you're taking my name now. I perform as Lady A. Now you're Lady A as well? Anita White is her name, and she's done some albums. She works at the Public Utilities. I love that, right in Seattle. I love that.
Oh, wow.
Was, when all this hit earlier this year, she was going to actually release another album for her birthday. And here's what she said. This is my life. They're using a name because of BLM. That's just the moment in time, you know, for them. But for her, it's her whole life. That's what she's trying to say.
Yeah.
And the result was a lawsuit where Lady A, the band, actually sued her on the declaratory judgment. Not everybody may know what that is. That's basically a device you can use if someone threatens to sue you.
Mm-hmm.
If they threaten to bring litigation, you can take them to court first. And then you become the plaintiff when you should have been the defendant. So I haven't checked in on this. I should have probably before this presentation where it's at. I'm sure it's probably still out there. I don't think they settled. At least I didn't hear that they settled this case.
I don't think so. Saying, I think there's some countersuit as well going on at the same time. So.
Oh, is a countersuit as well?
Yeah, I think they're from Lady A. Yeah, from
the original Lady A.
The original Lady A, yeah. So.
They're saying basically they want the court to declare that they're the lawful owner of the Lady A mark, because like many corporate bands, and they are a corporate band, as you can see, they've incorporated as Lady A Entertainment. Mm-hmm. And they also file a trademark on Lady A, because if you have a smart trademark lawyer like Shuba used to be, then you'll not only file, you know, names, but you'll file derivatives of those names, such as Lady Annabelle and Lady A, et cetera. And they use that, I think, or they've sold merchandise and the likes. So they have all the indicia of trademark use. But trademark law does say that the senior user should have rights over a junior user. And we all thought this is just going to settle. And you know, maybe they both can use it and not step on each other's toes. That often happens in trademark disputes. You know, they're nationwide. She's probably not. I'm guessing she's going to be local in the Seattle area, you know, in the Northwest. And they could give her a bunch of money because they have a bunch of money to give. Right. So I was kind of shocked this didn't settle. We don't know what's going on behind the scenes. They said that she demanded $10 million, and that's probably too much, right? I don't think $10 million, but maybe a million's about right, I would say, for it, if they want to continue. It's worth a lot to them to use this. They're going to make a lot more than $1 million, right, off of Lady A. But yeah, they decided not to go that route.
Yeah. And who knows what her plans were. I mean, her plans may have been to go national. I mean, right? I mean, so.
Right, although one thinks if it hadn't happened in 20 years, the music industry being what it is, it probably isn't going to happen now.
Fair enough. That's all, you know,
fantasy. My good trademark lawyer friend David Branfin out here said, why not just take her on tour with you?
Yeah, have her be the opening act.
Yeah, give her that visibility. And so I'm not going to go through this basic trademark stuff.
Yeah, no.
Why don't we wrap up slowly?
Why don't we wrap up?
Because I think I'm just about on time. I said 30 minutes and we're just about there.
Yeah.
I'm not going to talk about the slants or about Black Lives Matter's trademark.
I'll ask some questions about the slants. I mean, we can share the slides. A lot of great information here. But what do you think about the slant case, the First Amendment issues and the Simon Tam case?
That's a good question. Well, I remember I had the pleasure of actually seeing them twice. I saw them in Boston. I want to say it was 2017 when I was speaking at Boston University at a conference, and they were the entertainment for the conference. Were you there for that, Shuba?
I've been on panels with Simon Tam. I don't think I was at that conference. No,
you weren't at that one.
Yeah,
and it was fun watching a whole bunch of law professors.
Yeah,
you know, go out and try to dance on the dance floor. That was a pretty good. Funny memory.
I mean, actually, Simon Tam was supposed to come to Syracuse last spring, and we decided to postpone it, not so much because of COVID, because of some other issues that were happening on campus regarding racial slurs and so forth. So it's an interesting. We'll talk about that maybe some other time, Kevin. So.
Yeah, you can talk about that. You know, and then I saw him last year, I want to say, at USD Law School. I was a visiting professor at USD Law School.
Yeah.
And I saw him.
Yeah,
and he spoke. And quite honestly, I respect him and I understand his passion for this. Yeah. I completely disagree with him because his position is that this is empowering Asian Americans. And I'm not going to speak for that group. Trust me, I've never speak for somebody else's struggle, et cetera. But it goes beyond Asian Americans, right? it affects all communities and communities of color, particularly the decision. And so he won this case in the Supreme Court. He has the right to use this land because the Lanham Act Section 2 had a provision that said you can't register a mark, which is what? Is it scandalous, immoral, et cetera? Right. Yeah. It's that section of the Lanham Act. Mm-hmm. And the Supreme Court ultimately ended up saying, yeah, on a First Amendment basis, Section 2 is unconstitutional. Right. Now, what that means going forward is unclear. I think even today, even though this was about 4 years ago, 5 years ago, this case.
For the disparaging marks, they said that, you know, it was, I mean, my big beef with the case has to do with the reasoning, because they sort of say, well, for the government agency to deny a right based upon the government agency finding something to be disparaging is, viewpoint discrimination. And I guess, you know, this raises the question as to whether disparagement is a viewpoint that, I mean, to a certain extent, it is. It does open up the question about what else in the Trademark Act is a viewpoint, right? I wasn't happy with the reasoning of the case. I think there are problems.
Trademark is not a divine right. It is.
Oh yeah, of course, right.
Trademarks are denied all the time for many different reasons, right? And just because the registration is denied doesn't mean you can't use the mark, right?
Everybody
knows trademark law knows that. And so to say that this is some divine right and it's a First Amendment violation if we don't register, I don't agree with that at all. But even more importantly, to Simon's point, you know, and he spoke very movingly about how the discrimination he experienced growing up and all the kids that he's interacted with in the Asian community who are bullied in schools and the like because they're Asian. Obviously, this is outrageous. It's completely wrong. I don't see at all how this case helps those people. Because he said this is who he's fighting for. And he could never explain, well, how does that actually help the young Asian, you know, high schooler or junior high schooler who's being bullied by racist kids who are making fun of him because he's Asian? I don't see any connection with that. This case to me is not about anybody's liberation. And maybe I'm old school, but who is it? Ron Coleman, right, was the attorney for the band. Going up, I think, all the way up to the Supreme Court. And he's a fine attorney. He said, in dealing with this issue from the beginning, it was very clear that the Trademark Office did not want to register the slants as a mark, because if they did that, they would have to register the N-word. And that was what was paramount on the Trademark Office's mind. Apropos of what you're talking about, I think we can all agree the Trademark Office is probably not the appropriate place to be making these big judgments about what's socially acceptable and what's not. I mean, it's not a diverse place, right? It's not representative at all, like many of our IP institutions. And maybe there's a bigger point there, Shuba, that these representative.
I mean, the primary evidence, or one of the pieces of evidence, is that the, you know, as far as the First Amendment issue, is that the Trademark Office was being inconsistent. I mean, they were but I mean, that's not necessarily an argument for allowing all the trademarks, and that might be an argument for what you're suggesting, that the office itself needs to be a bit more, you know, diversified in terms of identifying things that are, but I mean, it's an interesting quandary, right? But I think the underlying question about, you know, this denial of a benefit to what's essentially a commercial right, I thought the court just sort of expanded First Amendment protection in a way that I found a little bit, consistent with what's doing with commercial speech in other areas that I find a bit troubling. So,
yes. Well, look,
but I'm in the minority. I'm the outsider there.
I'm sympathetic with Simon Tam, and I'm sympathetic with, historically, disadvantaged groups, subordinated groups, reclaiming negative, connotations and words, and that's what he said he was doing.
I don't want to, again, I respect him a lot. I've talked with him, and we're looking forward to having him out in Syracuse. And it's
the respect is there, no doubt.
You know, I thought the whole rhetoric of I think, again, I may be corrected on this, of drawing a parallel to Rosa Parks was probably a little bit extreme, but it was also interesting because we're getting into a very area that I've been doing some writing on, I've been doing some thinking on. It's just the kind of intersection between civil rights and economic rights here, because, arguably, the court in its First Amendment decision, sort of sees this as kind of a commercial speech type case at some level, because it's just giving a benefit, a commercial benefit, or a denial of a commercial benefit.
It's putting the imprimatur of the U.S. government on these words, and they haven't registered the N-word next. I don't see anything. I see nothing to prevent the N-word from being registered. Right.
Well, I think there have been some registrations, but they've been done preemptively. But I mean, that creates a problem with the use requirement and trademark, right? Because, you know, you can't just register something. If your point of registering is to keep other people from using it, well, you've got to use it in order to get the registration. So there's sort of a catch 22.
Right. You can do an ITU and you can stretch it out for a long time, but at
right.
some point,
yeah, right. Strategic. Right. You can, yeah. So you can just, you know, play with those kind of bureaucratic games, and maybe that's sort of the point that they're trying to do. But it's interesting.
You mentioned Rosa Parks, though, by the way, and you remember this one, right?
Yeah.
It was Outkast, and the song is Rosa Parks.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Song of Rosa Parks. That's Outkast. Of course, as you know, Shuba, Rosa Parks sued Outkast.
Right.
Asking for millions of dollars.
Yeah.
Because they did a song called Rosa Parks. And so, actually, Rosa Parks is beyond reproach by me, certainly, and I think by anyone.
Absolutely, yeah.
However, right. And also, the other thing is that she was very, very elderly, and I don't think she had capacity. I don't think Rosa Parks, I don't know this, but I don't think she instituted that suit. I think the people around her representatives instituted the suit. Because
it wasn't a successful suit, was it? Was it?
Yeah, she prevailed on that in the Sixth Circuit.
With damages,
completely wrongly
yeah,
decided.
Okay, that's an odd decision. Yeah, that's an odd outcome. Okay,
right. Thank the Sixth Circuit. But yeah. So you know that she, in that instance, anyway, she wasn't acting as a beacon of like First Amendment, because she felt, or her representatives, I think she died, by the way, by the time the suit went through the Sixth Circuit, she had already been dead a number of years.
Yeah, that's what. Okay, yeah, right. That's what made me wonder about the success of the suit. But yeah. Go ahead. Yeah, that's interesting.
So, you know, that's an example of someone saying, I don't want you using my name, right, in this way.
Right. Or, you know, wanting to cultivate. I mean, it's interesting. It's very, you know, it's parallel to what the King estate does with, you know, Martin Luther King's intellectual.
Very aggressive.
So, yeah, very aggressive.
Yeah, they're very protective of King's legacy. Yeah. Malcolm X estate as well.
Yeah. Which, you know, is understandable at some level, because, you know, there's a, you had Trump's slide up earlier, but, you know, Trump is an appropriationist, and he's, you know, a lot of the whatever the movement you want to call it, I mean, there are lots of different, you know, aspects of it, but they're sort of appropriating a lot of the rhetoric or language of the civil rights movements. I mean, that's sort of what the whole reverse discrimination kind of language has been about since the 70s. So it's a bit, it's a bit troubling when you see that, and you can understand then why it's important to sort of understand what the civil rights, you know, the core values of that were. I mean, and that's why I find these kind of, you know, debates now, especially with TAM, is how we're thinking about these rights. And I don't know if you want to talk about a post-civil rights era. I think, you know, some scholars have used that phrase. I don't know what that means exactly, but I like to think about it as this sort of intersection of what civil rights and economic rights would be. I mean, that's, you know, that's clearly where Martin Luther King was going before he was killed. And
yeah, absolutely.
Certainly in the Black Muslim movement, there's, you know, there is an aspect of economic autonomy as well, you know, so, and certainly in the whole.
Right, but, you know,
going back to the labor movement. I mean, I could go on. I'm rambling at this point, but there's a lot going on here.
Of course not. You never ramble. You know, the African American community, though, you know, specifically, it's unfortunate that the focus wasn't more on what IP can do. We know that IP is a driver of the U.S. economy. It's a driver of the global economy, And in terms of African Americans, people talk about reparations now. One of the things that this new movement has kind of done is I think it's starting to make people, some slower and some faster, realize we're not going to have this equity that corporate America is talking about unless there's some form of reparations. It's just not going to happen. I mean, there are African Americans like me, you know, who are well off, and, you know, we're always going to be okay. But to the great bulk of people, to really equalize the playing field, you'll have to give reparations. I think that's dawning on people now, right? All this other stuff, the marching and everything, nothing's going to change until that happens. And my argument, and that's what I'll be talking about at USC next month, is that it's very easy to do that, or easier, let's put it that, in the music space than in any other area of American life or society. And the reason why, I wrote the only, as far as I know, still the only law review article about African-American music and reparations back in 08, and I'm going to refresh it now. I haven't even done it, and I've already had a couple of journals say, hey, will you just give us that article, right? We would have published that. So wonderful. This is very hot stuff now.
That's wonderful, yeah.
Yeah, but you know, here's why it's easier. For slavery, reparations is hard. They didn't keep good records. On my father's side, they were African slaves. On my mother's side, they were free people of color. They were mulattoes, very light-skinned, you know, almost white people. And so there were very good records on my mother's side. On Ancestry.com, I could find everything. On my father's side, nothing. The records were horrible. They didn't see these slaves as humans. So they didn't keep great records about who owned what and when. So, and there's a whole host of other problems there. For music, it's very different. For music, pretty much three companies monopolize the entire global music market. And you can go back all the way to 1909 or even earlier, 1920, pick a date. You can find a record label that exists, and I could probably show you their successor corporation and who owns those rights today. You know, because copyright lasts a long time, as you know. Yeah. You know.
Right. And the reparations don't have to be, you know, it's not, people have this vision about, you know, sort of just somebody writing a check. It's a lot more complicated than that, right? It's also, you know, creating pathways for developing artists, you know, thinking about,
of course,
you know, creating schools. You know, we talk about STEM schools, but we also have, you know, school for the arts, and there are all sorts of things we could do that.
All sorts of things.
Yeah.
You know, we just did this Music Modernization Act. That could have been done in that act, right? It wasn't.
Yeah.
The reason why is, and I write about this in a piece, my piece on copyright terminations, I'll send it to you, in hip hop music. But, you know, I talk about, you know, of course, obviously the history of copyright, treatment of African Americans. And, you know, in 1909, when the 1909 Copyright Act was enacted, there were no African Americans in the room. Or people of color, or probably even women. And in 1955, when we started revising the 1909 Act, that lasted until 1978. There were no African Americans in the room. There were no people from these various groups in the room. And I understand the same was true of the Music Modernization Act, pretty much, which was just done a couple of years ago. So nothing's changing, Shuba. And until the right people get in that room, nothing's going to change on this for it.
And that's a good way to end. I mean, we could talk forever. I wish we could. Maybe we can continue this.
I love talking with you, of course.
And you got a lot of speaking engagements, and hopefully this will give some more traction for some more. You know, when the
This is the first time I've done this one, right?
Yeah.
So I'm happy to have done it with you.
Put it on the YouTube channel. But you know, I think the bottom line for me, and I don't want to, you know, I don't want to have the last word. I'm going to give that to you in a minute. But you know, what you're talking about is the need for real creative lawyering in this space. You know, it's, you know, we can have the theories and everything, and we could have talked a bit about Rawls. You mentioned Rawls and different theories of social justice. But I think what the path you're setting, Professor Greene, is talking about, you know, lawyering. I mean, you know, we haven't, you know, evoked Justice Ginsburg's name at all. And obviously her work in the women's movement also is about the intersection between civil rights and economic rights. But she's also a paragon of understatement of the year, but, you know, successful lawyering, very powerful lawyering. And I think the kind of things you've talked about are other examples of that in the IP space. And so, you know, I think that's, you know, that's the lesson I get out of this, and I hope other people can take. But, you know, there's a lot of things you touched upon. So thank you for taking the time. And I want to give you the last word. give us our marching orders. Tell us what you'd like us
to do. Well, first of all, thanks again for inviting me. You've been a great friend and colleague over the years, Shubha, and I really appreciate you. I appreciate your work, but I appreciate the man as much as I appreciate the work as well. So I appreciate that a lot. I think right now that we, you know, the nature of openings is they close. And we're in an opening moment now where, in, quite honestly, white America, because as African-Americans, as people of color, we've known about this, right? This is our everyday reality in our life. But white America has kind of woken up and saying, maybe things aren't as fair and equitable as I thought. You know, maybe these problems can exist. We could kind of use that to leverage, to get fairness and to get equity. And so my whole thing is looking backwards. Yes, I do believe there has to be some, restorative justice, because everybody hates the word reparations. Right, and just piggybacking on something you said, Professor Brooks, Roy Brooks, says that every movement for quote unquote reparations begins with an apology. Mm-hmm. So the first thing might be to have the American entertainment industry with all its racist movies and the American music industry with all its cultural appropriation, economic appropriation, apologize. Say, hey, this is wrong, we did it. And then we can go on from there and say, okay, great, how do we write this? In terms of going forward, I think my work on terminations, it is a form of reparations. If we could really make a recapture, copyright recapture system that was fair and usable for artists, that would be a form of reparations. Because as you know, under copyright termination, copyright recapture, artists after 35 years under this current act, they're allowed to get their music back. Right, and if they got a crappy deal in the beginning, get a good deal. So those are two concrete areas of reform I'm really pushing for. I have a lot more besides that, but in the short time, I wanted to put that bug in people's ears.
Well, thank you so much, and we look forward to your other speaking engagements. We're connected on Facebook and other social media, so we'll prop all that stuff up. And good luck with that, and good luck with all your work, and thank you for all your work as well.
Thank you, Professor Ghosh. Thank you, Syracuse.